Thank you for the invitation. So I don't know if I'm a specialist, but I've been working for now more than 15 years, even 20 years on this topic. But in fact, originally I was essentially interested in quantization as a numerical method. In fact, with other collaborators, I was one of those who promoted with more or less success this method as a numerical method. But in fact, vector quantization comes from another field of mathematics, or let's say science, since it has been originally devised for signal processing, essentially signal transmission, and then was extensively used as an unsupervised learning method. And it's still used, in fact, massively as an unsupervised learning method. And there is a project in this SEMRAX which will use quantization as a clustering method, automatic classification method. And so now it's very up to date, so because it deals with all the topic people are interested in applied mathematics, or at least in the random part of applied mathematics. So I will start now. So as I just said, it goes back to the late 40s. In fact, it was for radar emissions that quantization was devised. I will come back later on a more technical point of view, but you can have the idea. Oops. That you have a signal and then you discretize it in some sense by projecting it on some points, here, 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 here. And then you don't transmit the signal. You can transmit the discretized point or not, or even some label associated to this point. And then the receiver of the signal reconstructs the signal from what he or she receives, which are either the points or the labels, if you have a Bible, making a connection between the labels and the discretization point. So the main example are the pulse code modulation, and it's also, in fact, included in the GPEG compression method. Okay, if you're interested in all these aspects, which goes back to the 50s, but have been developed during the second part of the 20th century, you can have a look at this very good book, Learning Vector Quantization, which is an extensive survey about the IEEE history. And you have this book by Graf and Lushge, which is a more mathematical book, which treats with the foundation of quantization for probability distribution. It's a book of measure theory, essentially, and which is very far from the scope and the way things are written, very different from the Gershow and Gray's book. And myself, I wrote a survey, in fact, at the occasion of the 2013 SEMRAX, where I gave a course on quantization. So I'm supposed to be a specialist, I guess, finally. And in statistics, it has been used, and it's still massively used, as an unsupervised learning method or clustering. It's also known as a K-means in English, as nuée dynamique in French. It has been introduced by several authors, among them McQueen and Lloyd, etc., in the 60s. And many of the authors, like Lloyd, for example, and others, were working at the Bell Laboratories, in fact, in the late 40s and early 50s. And it was a secret field, because it was entirely supported by the American Army and the defense industry. And finally, everything was published, not everything, but many contributions were published in the 1984, I guess, in IEEE on information theory issue. And it was a very strange and interesting opportunity to see that many people published in this journal various proof of the same results, but they didn't know that the other proved it because they were all working separately. And as would say my colleague Harald Lushgi, anyway, all these guys were from information theory and all the proofs were false. So he's a bit pessimistic, but it's partly true that they were false. Okay, so what rough quantization is, you consider a random vector having value in RD, and your aim, so with a finite p moment, for example, so in most application p is equal to 1 and even more often equal to 2, and the aim is to discretize partially x, that means to replace x by a random variable taking infinitely many values, and we hope that this approximation will be as close as possible to x. So if you remember what I said 2 minutes ago about this, you see that that's exactly the problem when you are transmitting a signal. You want to discretize a signal, so here the signal is capital X, and you want to replace it by a random variable taking infinitely values. So if you consider any function, a priori any generic function q, small q from RD to gamma, so you can call gamma a grid, and then you can replace x by q of x, that we will denote by x hat, and you can call it quantization of x. So it's like an estimator in statistics. So far we said nothing, we just changed the name, but you will see that it will have other restriction and consequences. So the simplest example, if you consider uniformly or even any random variable taking value in the unit interval, you may choose, for example, the midpoint quantization. That means that you send small x to 2k minus 1 over 2 capital N if x is between k minus 1 over n and k over n. So you know intuitively that if x is uniformly distributed over the 0-1 interval, this will be a very efficient way to quantize the uniform distribution, or random variable with this uniform distribution. But you imagine that, for example, if x has a distribution which is not at all uniform, with a big hole, for example, around 1/2, this won't be an optimal way to proceed. So you see immediately that the way to choose small q in a smart way is, of course, strongly connected to the random variable x, or to be more precise, to its distribution. So that a way to measure, of course, the error that you make when you replace capital X by Q of capital X is just to consider the difference between these two, and then to consider the LP norm depending on what you're interested in. Okay, so the first way to be a bit smarter, a bit more more clever than taking any function q, is to think about the geometric approach to quantization. That means for a fixed grid, I remind you that grid is simply a subset of size, let's say capital N in RD. You know that whatever the function q having value in gamma is, the absolute value of the norm between x and q of x is always greater or equal than the distance between x and the set gamma, the grid gamma. Thank you. So I know it's very smart to this remark. So, but what is more clever is to remark that, to ask whether this inequality may hold as an equality for an appropriate function q. And in fact, the answer is very simple from a geometric point of view. When you write things, it's a bit more involved, but I will make a drawing in the next slide. Given a finite grid x1, x2, xn in RD, we will define the nearest neighbor projection on gamma. And how to proceed? In fact, you consider the Voronoi partition of RD induced by the grid gamma. That means for every xi in gamma, every element xi in gamma, you consider ci of gamma, the set of points of vector in RD, which are closer to xi than any other xj. In fact, we consider a partition and you assume that this quantity is included in this set because you have, of course, the problem of overlapping on the boundaries. That means on points which are on the median hyperplane between xi and xj. The underlying norm is always the canonical Euclidean norm. You can do the whole theory with any norm, but in that case, what we call a median hyperplane may have a positive Lebesgue measure when you consider, for example, the L-infini or L1 norm, the small L-infini or the sup-norm or the small L1 norm on RD. So forget about that. We will always consider the canonical Euclidean norm. So we consider this partition. And to any such partition, we associate the projection, the nearest neighbor projection on gamma induced by this partition by replacing simply when you have some vector xi in RD, you replace xi by xi when xi is in the cell of xi. So that in that case, you can check very easily, it's just made for it, that xi minus its projection, nearest neighbor projection on gamma is exactly equal to the distance between xi and gamma. So we can define the quantization, the Voronoi quantization of a random vector x by the grid gamma as its nearest neighbor projection on gamma. So you have infinitely many nearest neighbor projection because of this problem on the boundaries between the cells, but in fact it's not really a problem for various reasons, and especially when x has a density. Okay, so we have 4 points here. Our grid has 4 points. So you can depict here the Voronoi diagram associated to these 4 points. So you have x1 here, x2, x3, x4. So c1 of this grid gamma is this area here. c2 is this area. c3 of gamma is this area. And c4 of gamma is this area. Okay, and now you have x of omega that falls on the plane. Of course, here we have just on the two-dimensional plane R2. So x of omega falls inside this cell, and so you can replace simply xi by this point of the grid. So that's very simple. You cannot really imagine simpler as a process. And in that case, when you consider this kind of projection, you know that the distance between x and gamma, which is in fact the distance between our nearest neighbor projection that we will denote from now on always x hat gamma, or x hat when no ambiguity, is the projection on gamma of x. And we know that the error, the mean LP error induced by replacing x by x hat is equal to the distance between x and gamma. So here it's in L1 or in L2 if you are interested in L2. Alors, why considering this quantity, for example, if you're interested in numerical probability? Because if you want to compute for a function which is Lipschitz continuous on RD the expectation of f of x, you can replace it by the expectation of f of x hat, and as x hat takes finitely many values in gamma, this will appear as a weighted sum in the end. We'll come back to that later on. So it's dominated by the Lipschitz coefficient of f times the L1 mean quantization error between x and x hat. And this is exactly equal, as I've just said, to the distance, to the L1 norm of the distance between x and gamma. And since the function, in fact, xi mapped to the distance between xi and gamma is itself one Lipschitz, in fact, you see that you have inequality between this supremum of this quantity over all function of Lipschitz function with Lipschitz coefficient lower than 1 and this quantity. So put in a more up-to-date and fashionable world, the L1 distance between x and gamma, or the L1 distance between x and its Voronoi quantization on gamma is equal to the L1 Wasserstein distance between the law of x and the set of probability distribution supported by the grid gamma. And so in some sense, it's already an optimum in some sense. But there is something else to optimize, as we will see. So in signal transmission, so before here it was quantization theory or numerical probability in some sense. In signal transmission, of course, the distance between X and gamma in L1 or L2 measures exactly the mean error transmission of the signal. Okay. So now let's think about the third aspect, the more statistical aspect. What is the connection with classification or clustering or unsupervised learning? In fact, you imagine that you have a data set, Xi k. Alors, here you have a paradox because small n will be large and capital N will be small. I'm sorry, but I had other constraints when I was not dealing with classification. So the data set is Xi k, k between 1 and small n. And in fact, we will assume that the random variable x is just a model of the sampling of one data uniformly at random in the data set. That means that p, the law of x, so for probabilists, the natural notation is p under subscript x, is the empirical measure associated to the data set. For a statistician, in fact, you start from that and you forget about this X, this capital X. So gamma, in that case, is no longer a grid. It's a set of prototypes. It's a set also of code words. That means the element X1, XI here of the grid are called prototypes, code words, elementary quantizer. Sometimes it's called centroids too, but in a special situation where they are stationary, we will come back to that later on. And the size of the set of prototypes is capital N, which is very small in front of small n. And in that case, the above L1 mean error that I mentioned in the former slides can be written simply as 1 over small n, the size of the data set, the sum of the distance between each term of the data, each element of the data set to its closest neighbor in the set of prototypes. And so in some sense, this quantity is considered in L1, but also in L2, or in fact, if you want, in any LP, as a measure of how the set of prototypes gamma, capital gamma, sums up in some sense, is a good sum up of the set of the data set Xi k. Okay, so here you have an example, a very simple example. The red bullets are the code words, and the crosses are the vectors or the data here. And so you see that you can classify these crosses by considering that you are in a given class if you are in the class of the centroid to the to which you belong to the Voronoi cell, etc., and reverse. So my English is falling down. Okay, you understood what I meant. That means that simply that the class are defined by the Voronoi cells of the prototypes, and this produces a classification. Here, given how the points are dispatched on the unit square, you see that in fact it's a reasonable classification. But of course, you can also imagine the main problem in some sense is how large must be the size of your set of prototypes, that means of your grid. Because of course, if you have only two red bullets, it will not provide the same classification as if you take 3, 4, 5, etc. And you must always have in mind, of course, that the number of code words, capital N, must be small in front of, with respect to the data set. So, in the title of my talk, there is the word optimal. So far, we never really optimized anything except that we had a very natural strategy which consists in considering only Voronoi quantization, that means nearest neighbor projections, to replace x by x hat. But is there an optimal way to select the grid? That's the point in some sense, or the n quantizer, that means the capital gamma, to classify the data, for example. In data analysis, that means is there an optimal clustering of your data set? So once again, we will consider the LP mean quantization error, but this time, so we will denote it by EPE like error, P by reference to LP, X by reference to the random variable X, but in fact we should put the distribution mu or PX of X, because all that depends only on the distribution, and gamma, so is the grid or the set of code words or of prototypes. We consider, so once again, this distance between X and gamma in LP, but now we'll look at this quantity as a function of gamma. That's the point which will allow us to perform an optimization. More precisely, we will try to solve this problem. We define the LP mean quantization minimal optimal problem as trying to find the infimum among all grid contained in RD with size at most capital N, and we want to minimize the LP quantization error, which is here, which can be also expressed like that, in that way. Okay, so here I could have put xi, xi in gamma, xi. Maybe it will be clearer. Okay. And Voronoi quantization can do more than that, because if you consider any random variable, capital xi, you can note that if you use it to approximate capital X, point-wise, omega by omega, this is still greater than the distance between the X of omega and capital Xi, the set of value of capital Xi, which is capital Xi of capital omega, and this is of course equal, as we already see, as the distance between X of omega, small omega, and the Voronoi quantization of X by the element of X of capital Xi of capital omega. So in that case, you can show that in fact our error modulus here, this quantity in fact is not only the best approximation of X by a random variable which are function of X and takes at most n value, it's more generally the best approximation of X by any random variable capital Xi which takes at most capital n value, and is of course in that case LP integrable, and once again it's the Wasserstein L1 distance between PX and the set of the low on X of X, sorry, and the probability distribution whose support has at most capital N value. So this minimal problem is more general than just quantization. It solves the question of computing this L1 Wasserstein distance. Okay. So what can we say to do a bit more mathematics, because so far it was just elementary remarks. So there is a theorem which is the starting point of all the theory, which is due to many authors between from the late 40s to the 2000, where a proof has been provided, a rigorous proof has been provided for in the most general case. So what happens? You consider any p between 0 and plus infinity, and then what we know that for any level capital N, there always exists at least one LP optimal quantization grid, gamma star capital N at level N, and the resulting quantization error, minimal quantization error, so there is always a solution to the former minimization problem, and this solution decreases as capital N goes to infinity, and it decreases to zero. That means that you have always a perfect approximation asymptotically, which is no real surprise, and what is more important, that if P is equal to 2, you can show that any optimal quantizer in the quadratic case satisfies what is called the self-consistency property by statisticians, or stationarity property by people from numerical probability, which says that the expectation of X given its quantization, optimal quadratic quantization at level N, is equal to its quantization, optimal quantization. And we'll see in a few seconds what it means. But how to prove that first? So what's the trick? In fact, you proceed to have the existence of an optimal quantizer. You just proceed by induction. When capital N is equal to 1, you are just facing a convex function, xi and LP norm of capital X minus xi, which is convex, coercive, so it attains its minimum at the LP median. It's the definition of the LP median, so when P is equal to 2, it's the expectation, when P is equal to 1, it's the median. And when you want to switch from capital N to size capital N plus 1, you just consider, so we will assume that it always exists because we don't care for with the case of the support of the law of X is finite, but you consider X in the support of the law of X, minus, but which is not in the optimal grid at level n. So you add a point to the grid gamma star n, which is LP optimal at level n. So you consider this grid, and you know that, of course, it's very, very simple to check that the quantization error at level n plus 1 induced by this new grid, the former optimal grid plus union with xi, in fact, this level of quantization to the P is lower than the optimal quantization level n, at level n. So that you can prove, once you have done that the set of grid of size n plus 1 for which the quantization error to the P induced by this grid is lower than this level, in fact, it's non-empty because it contains this grid. It's closed by continuity, it's obvious. But what is more important is that it is bounded. And why is it bounded? Because if you send one of the components of the grid gamma to infinity, you have no longer n plus 1 component in gamma. Morally speaking, you have only n component. And in that case, by Fatou's lemma, it's very simple inside using this quantity to show that you will contradict the fact that you are lower than this quantity, which is strictly lower than the minimum quantization error at level capital N. So you can show that this set is non-empty, closed, and bounded. So if I remember well my courses of undergraduate, it's a compact set, and on the compact set, you have a minimum. And it's clear that, so gamma is a grid, it's a set, it's not an n-tuple. Okay, you have to write some few details, but okay, it's no problem. And if you are in fact, this proof can be extended in infinite dimension. That's the prototype of the proof for the existence of optimal quantizer, which is not much more difficult, but which, in my opinion, rather nice, is how to prove that a quadratic quantizer is always stationary. In fact, the idea is very simple. You consider the quantization of X by this optimal quantizer, so the projection of X on with the nearest neighbor rule on gamma and star, and you make the difference with the conditional expectation of X given this optimal quantization. By definition of conditional expectation, this quantity is orthogonal to all the random variables which are function of X hat, gamma and star. So you can apply the Pythagoras theorem, which says that this error here to the square is equal to this error to the square plus this, the square of this error, which is as obviously a function of X hat, gamma and star. So this quantity is definitely orthogonal to this one. So you can write this. But now, what do you know? You know that the conditional expectation of X given X hat is the best approximation of X among all possible functions of X hat. So necessarily, you see that by uniqueness implies that this is the conditional expectation, that this quantity cannot be better than this quantity, and so you have the equality by uniqueness of conditional expectation. Okay, so in that case, it's very easy, in fact, in probabilistic terms, to prove that an optimal quadratic quantizer is stationary. Usually, it takes more effort in a statistical textbook. But well, they do that by a more constructive way. So if you come back for a second to signal transmission, to not just to deal with a numerical probability application, what happens in some sense in that case, you do some statistics and you can using algorithms that we will define later on, you can show that gamma star n you can have access to an optimal quantization of your signal supposed to be stationary. That means it's always it has always the same distribution at each time t. It may even be in fact periodic, for example. It's no longer probability, but it still works. So the preprocessing is to, in fact, label all your all the element of your optimal grid in such a way that the labels, that means 1, 2, etc., up to n, satisfies the fact that the probability that x hat is equal to x star I is decreasing. That means that you will transmit p1 more often than p one more often. 1 than 2, 2 than 3, etc., etc. Then the second preprocessing is to encode I. So there are several ways to do that. You can use dyadic code, that means just code I in base 2, but you have much more efficient way like the gray code, etc. So it's whole theory which is a bit far from our field, my field of expertise, but it does exist. And A, who wants to emit the signal, and B, to receive it. In fact, they both share the one-to-one Bible, X star I and the code of I. And once X is encoded, the code of I is transmitted, then decoded. And you have the if you use a naive encoding by dyadic expansion, you see that the complexity, in fact, of the procedure, the mean complexity of the procedure is, of course, the mean length of the code you transmit. It's of the roughly speaking of the form of the size of the log n, where n is the size of the global grid. And if you have, for example, a uniform signal, you can prove it's approximately the log of n minus n over e, where e is the base of a Neperian logarithm. And this is, in fact, the first step to the very famous theorem in information theory, which is called the Shannon source coding theorem, which is a way to analyze the complexity of the transmission in a very smart way using large deviation methods to show that you have optimal optimal quantizer in some sense based on some random quantizers. But of course, I won't go in that direction, which would ask a specific effort, and I prefer to come back to numerical probability at this stage. So, what is it for? In fact, in numerical probability, the starting point, which is not our final aim, is just to produce cubature formula. That means you can replace this expectation of f of x by the expectation of f of this quantization. And as we just saw, this quantity is a weighted sum of the value of f at xi star, and the value of f here is the probability that capital X is equal to xi here. This quantity is equal to that. So what do we need to do numerical probability? We need the distribution to have the law, the probabilistic law of x hat in details. And how to perform this grid optimization and the computation of the weights? You have ready-to-use procedure, which has been devised a long time ago by Lloyd in 1982. It was published in 1982, but it goes back to the 50s, I guess. And competitive learning vector quantization, which has been introduced by several authors independently, but the first one was probably McQueen, and it was in the 1967, I guess, something like that. But what is interesting, essentially, when we deal with a modern problem of numerical probability, like discretization of backward or forward-backward equation, etc., it's the fact that, which is very natural, as it has been mentioned this morning by Xavier, for example, the main challenge as soon as you are facing non-linear problems in numerical probability of any kind. It starts by, let's say, American options, but it can be many other problems like those that has been mentioned this morning. You have to compute some conditional expectation. That's the challenge. And conditional expectation is especially designed not to be computed easily. That's the principle of conditional expectation. So a natural idea here, of course, is to replace not only X in the conditional expectation, but also the conditioning random variable by their quantized version. So you replace the expectation of F of X given Y by the expectation of F of X hat given Y hat. And of course, when you have done that, you didn't do much, but we'll see why it is a natural way to proceed if you want to have some precise error bounds when you use this method to discretize, let's say, for example, BSD or reflected BSD. And the third application, as we just said, is clustering. So I essentially already said what is written here, so I won't repeat it, but this is probably and by far the more important in quantity, at least application of quantization. Okay, I won't speak about that because I won't have time today, but if you think of what I said so far, what is the role played by RD? Not much. At one moment, I said that a bounded, closed, non-empty set is compact. So it's not completely true in infinite dimension. You must have the weak somewhere. But in fact, it works. That means you can replace RD by a separable Hilbert space. So separable is very important because to say that the quantization error goes to zero, we need to have an everywhere dense sequence in the norm space. And in a reflexive Banach space, in fact, you can show that our function, that our error, quantization error, in fact, is lower semi-continuous for the product weak topology on the EN, where E is a Banach space, and a lower semi-continuous function for the weak topology attains its minimum on any weak compact, and our K, the K I was mentioning here, I don't remember where was it here, is still non-empty, still closed for the weak topology, and furthermore, it is weakly. It's bounded and it's weakly closed for the weak topology. So we essentially use that in infinite dimension, boundedness means weak compacity. Okay, and in fact, you can even, if you use the tau topology, which is a very special topology, you can prove that even in the L1 space, which as everybody knows is not a reflexive Banach space, you still have existence of optimal quantizer, but unfortunately in the only space you are really interested in, that means the space of continuous function, you cannot prove the existence of optimal quantizer, which is a kind of paradox because in many function spaces, like LP of DT spaces, for example, the optimal quantizer have continuous code words. That means that the function that make up the optimal quantizer are still continuous. But in the case of the space of continuous function, you cannot prove that you can even prove the non-existence in some cases of optimal quantizer. Okay, so as I just said, the convergence to zero of the quantization error needs the existence of an everywhere dense sequence. It's a very simple remark. You see, you consider just the grid made up with n first component of the everywhere dense sequence, and you apply the Lebesgue-dominated convergence theorem. So you see, everything is very elementary. So far, everything was very elementary, but in fact, what we are interested in, especially in numerical probability, but in fact, even in signal processing and clustering, is at which rate does this error modulus goes to zero as the level or the size of the quantization grid goes to infinity. And we need it at least for finite dimensional vector spaces, because I have no time to speak about functional quantization today. And in fact, the result was existing. It has been established. It has been stated and considered as established by Zador in his PhD thesis in 1963. But it was a confidential work, so it was not published or made public. But in fact, it was only done for the uniform distribution over the unit interval, the unit hypercube, using an argument, a self-consistency, self-similarity argument. Okay, inspired by a very famous mathematician whose name is, I miss the name at this very moment. But it has been improved by Kiefer, then by Buckle and Wise, but Graf and Lushge certify that all these proofs are not correct. And they provided a proof that I testify myself as correct in the 2000, in fact. Most ideas were there, in fact. It's just mathematicians are never satisfied with proofs which are made by people from information theory, but in fact everything was there, just a kind of a bit snobbish, but okay. Anyway, the result is true and can be found in these lecture notes. If X is a bit more than LP integrable, and if you can decompose this distribution as an absolutely continuous part with density phi and a singular part nu, then our optimal quantization error modulus, that means the lowest possible error approximation in LP of X by a random variable taking at most n value, if you normalize this error by capital N to the 1 over D, where D is the dimension of the space, you have a sharp convergence result with this quantity, which is not completely universal, but which does not depend on the distribution of X, times this pseudonorm, LD over D plus P, of the density of the absolutely continuous part of PX here. And what is this quantity QP with the norm here, because it's true for any norm, but so far I told you that we'll speak essentially about the canonical Euclidean norm, so let's keeping working with that norm. So this quantity is also the limit, but is the limit again. When imagine that phi is an indicator function of the unit hypercube, this quantity is equal to 1. So it's clear that QP here is equal to this limit when X has a uniform distribution over the unit hypercube, but it's also the infimum. It's not only the limit, it's the infimum, and you can obtain that, as I already told you, by self-similarity argument. Okay, and what is interesting and gave rise to many papers and investigations, that if phi is equal to 0, this is still true. I didn't say that phi was not equal to 0. So this quantity, of course, this limit is equal to 0. So we are not in the right asymptotics. But for many fractal-like spaces, you can find not D, but another real number here, for which you have a non-trivial limit. And you can call this D, which is not the D of RD, this D prime, let's say, we can call it the quantization dimension of a set. And there is a whole theory with a comparison with all the other measure of dimension, Hausdorff dimension, etc., etc. Which Siegfried Graf is probably the best specialist, or was because he's retired now, specialist of this problem. So this is even true with phi is equal to 0, but as far as we are concerned for our signal transmission, numerical probability, or statistics problem, it's not very interesting, because in statistics, when you do some data mining, you never have phi. Phi does not exist. So, but you have PX has a finite support in that case. huge but finite, so this kind of problem is meaningless. And in numerical probability, the contrary, we are interested in the case where mu is zero. But you see, this is sharp, but this is very depending on capital X. And so it was not very satisfactory to us. By us, I mean those who are interested in having error bounds in when discretizing equation. So we tried to improve that, and with my colleagues Siegfried Graf and Aaron Lushgi, we extended a so-called Pierce lemma to prove the following result, which is universal. That means that if you consider p prime greater than p, then there exists a constant depending only on p prime p and the dimension d, such that for any RD-valued random variable, the quantization error induced by the minimum quantization error induced by the distribution of X is upper bound by this universal constant times sigma p prime of X times n minus 1 over d. And what is sigma p prime of X? It's the pseudo-standard deviation associated to the LP prime norm, that means the infimum over RD of the LP prime of X minus A. Okay, so that's the fact that this is very nice, but this is of course very disappointing in some sense because of this 1 over d. This rate n minus 1 over d is known as the curse of dimensionality, and it appears in most non-linear problem in probability, either directly, either through the variance. Enfin, it's very difficult to get rid of this curse of dimensionality, and in fact, the main aim of people who are working in this field is to get rid of this curse of dimensionality, which is more or less hidden somewhere almost all the time. But here it's not really hidden, as you can see. Okay. So, now that we know at which rate it goes to zero, we are interested in fact computing, and I will finish the first part of the course by this question. Either you're interested for statistics, for signal transmission, for numerical probability, in any case, your aim when you deal with the quantization theory is to compute these quantizers, because if they are only a concept, the existence of these objects is not interesting in itself. You must have the ability to put them in a computer. But in fact, they are born, you can get them from a computer too. So what is the trick? The starting trick of all methods is to consider that an optimal grid at a given level, let's say capital N, all satisfies X hat is equal to the expectation of X given X hat. And that's the starting equality for all the procedure to compute optimal quantizer. If you rewrite that, you see, you can write, you consider this equality and you look at it on the set X hat is equal to X I. That means that X falls in the Voronoi cell of XI. Then, well, X hat star. So, of course, X hat is equal to that, and that this will be equal to what? To the expectation of X belong to this cell divided by the probability that X belongs to this cell. So you have a kind, if you look at that, this is a kind of function. You see that a stationary quantizer is a kind of fixed point of this function, which is sometimes called the Lloyd map. And so we want to take advantage of that. And there is another way that we will see to understand that. But if you look at this as a fixed point, you just divide this fixed point. So you consider the Lloyd's, it's called the Lloyd's 1 algorithm because he created then a second second algorithm. So after this second algorithm, they call the first method the Lloyd-Wade algorithm. So either in a randomized way as soon as you're in higher dimension, but you can imagine to implement it in a deterministic way in one or two dimension. What you do, you consider a starting grid here, gamma zero, x zero one, x zero capital N, and then the standard step to switch from the kth step to the kth plus one step of the procedure is that you just write that here, you apply this Itô map, so you compute the conditional expectation of x given the fact that x is in the ith cell of gamma k, the grid computed at time k, at iteration k, and you define like that xi k plus 1. And then you define the grid gamma I k plus 1 as the grid made up with that, and then you have to, in the end, consider at the next step you will do again x given x belong to ci gamma k plus 1, etc., etc., and you hope that it will converge. And of course it converges very often. But at this set I would like to just say a word of terminology, because what does it mean to be a stationary point here like that? It means that your point xi, in fact it's a stationary point because it is in fact the mean with respect to the law of x given the fact that x is in the cell, it's the conditional mean of x. So I repeated that several times, but that's why it is called a centroid. So in the case of a stationary quantizer, which is the case of an optimal quantizer, as we see in the quadratic case, as we saw 10 slides ago, in fact, the element of the grids are called the centroids because of this property. Okay, and what is important, it's essentially the same proof as that which shows that the optimal quadratic quantizer is a stationary quantizer. In fact, you can prove by the same method, in fact, that what is important is that the Lloyd's always makes the quantization error decrease. That means that you're sure that you improve your result. That means you improve you reduce your quantization error when you perform the Lloyd's algorithm. Unfortunately, that doesn't mean that the grid itself remains bounded. So in fact, after more than 50 years, there are very few results which are satisfactory concerning the fact that the grid itself converges except in one dimension. But it works very, very well in practice, and hundreds and even thousands of people use that in computer science and statistics to compute. It's the K-mean algorithm. It's known as the K-mean algorithm in statistics. And when d is equal to 1 and the law of x is log concave, then, in fact, you have exponentially fast convergence in this procedure. So it's very efficient to compute optimal quantizer. And as there is a kind of renewal of interest for the 1D, one-dimensional quantization for quadrature formulas, I think about the work by Calogaro et al. in Padova recently, who proposed a method to compete with a fast Fourier transform to compute derivatives when the density of the underlying asset has a closed Fourier transform, a closed form for its Fourier transform. Okay, but however, and I will stop that for the break, there is no general proof of convergence when the law has a non-compact support and when d is greater than 2. In fact, it's not completely true because I tried to do something with one of my PhD students which gave rise to a paper in SciCon in 2016, which is based on what is called the splitting method. The splitting method is just to imitate the proof of the existence of a quantizer. That means that I don't want to compute one quantizer, I want to compute a series of quantizers. So I compute the first one, and then I initialize to compute the second one by considering the first one with plus 1 point, etc., etc., etc. And of course, you may imagine that it stabilizes the procedure. Of course, it's time consuming because instead of computing one quantizer, you will have to compute 100 or 1000. So maybe it will take you 2 or 3 days. But for example, if you're interested in the numerical probabilities, that's something that you can do offline because you are interested in a typical distribution like normal distribution or something like or log normal distribution with a given a reasonable parameter. So you can compute, let's say, in dimension 3 or 4 to compute 100 grids will take you 1 hour, let's say. So you can spend 1 hour offline during the night to compute your grids. And then using this splitting method, it will be much more efficient than trying to compute a given grid of a given size. Okay. And furthermore, which is what was interested in that case, you can even prove under certain conditions that the procedure converges. That was what I was satisfied with at that time. Okay, and just my last sentence of this slide. Of course, what I described is a non, what I described is a theoretical procedure, because here you have some expectation, and as I wrote here, here you have to compute an expectation, here you have to compute a probability. So in fact, you have to randomize this procedure by doing some Monte Carlo, or in case of clustering, you have to sample your data set using bootstrapping method to compute this quantity. And of course, you lose the fact that it decreases at every step, but it remains almost true, but it's not completely true. It's a bit like a super martingale, which is almost a decreasing sequence, but not exactly. Okay, so I will stop maybe for 4 or 5 minutes, if everybody agrees. Okay, so we will resume. By a second method to compute optimal quantizers, stationary quantizers. So you can prove under the log normal, concavity assumption in one dimension that in fact stationary quantizers coincide with optimal quantizers, but it's not true in higher dimension. In higher dimension, we are trying to minimize a very intricated potential function. You have saddle points, you have local minima, local maxima, etc., etc. But anyway, we have to deal with that. So, what is the alternative method? It's a competitive learning vector quantization algorithm. It's still in the quadratic case. And in fact, we consider this time the what is called the quadratic distortion function, which is simply the square. It's simply the square of the quadratic quantization error. So it's the expectation of the minimum of here. I'm sorry, it's the norm in RD, so it's simple bars in my talk and not double bars, to the square. And this is a function of x1, xi, x capital N, and we want to minimize this function. So when we want to minimize a function, even if it's not a convex function, since if the norm is smooth enough, which is the case of the canonical Euclidean norm, this function is differentiable at all grids, that means all n tuple x1, xn, of full size, that means are pairwise distinct. And if this grid is equal to x1, xn, so you see, I'm embarrassed because I make always a confusion because the grid, which is a set, and x1, xn, which is an n tuple. But okay, you will forgive me because I forgive myself and we have no choice. So we compute this grid, we compute this partial derivative, and we fall upon twice the expectation of xi minus capital X for the ith component times the indicator function that x belongs to the ith component of the grid gamma. And if you write which is natural if you look for a minimum that the gradient, the global gradient of the distortion function is zero, you fall upon the fact that this quantity component by component is equal to zero. And writing that this quantity is equal to zero component by component, it's exactly the same thing as writing this equality. So you try by two completely different ways to minimize the quantization error, and you fall upon the same equation, except that here you just prove that you have the gradient of a function, the quadratic distortion function, which reads as the expectation of something. And in that case, if you should have a natural reflex, you can implement a stochastic gradient descent. So that's exactly what the competitive learning vector quantization is. So when d is equal to 1, you can write this distortion function with the usual convention of numerical analysis that the midpoint has written xi minus 1 half, xi plus 1 half, the midpoint between xi, x minus 1, xi, xi plus 1. So you write this function and you can differentiate it, and you can evaluate everything if you know the density, the cumulative distribution function, and the cumulative function of the first moment. And then you can even compute the SN of this function, and you can implement a Newton-Raphson algorithm, which is even much more performing than the CLVQ in its mean field version. And you may have in two or three or four iterations a very good accuracy on your quantization, on your quantizer, at least for capital N, not for a size not too large size. Then, in dimension greater than two, you must really adopt the stochastic version of this CLVQ. So you must have to simulate independent copies of x, xi1, xi2, etc., etc. If you are in a with a data set, that's why I adopted the same notation. If you consider a data set, you can also implement the stochastic gradient method by now using the data set as inputs of your algorithm. You generate a step sequence gamma 1, gamma 2 of the form A over capital B plus N, and you update your grid as follows. You have the selection phase and the learning phase. The selection phase, that means you select the winner, that means that you consider the point among, at step n, among the component of your grid, which is the closer to the input here, which should be, okay. And then what you do, then for this precise component, you update it by a dilatation centered at xi n with rate with dilatation coefficient 1 minus gamma n. You move it from the former point to the new point, and you let all the other points still. So what does it mean? It means that here you have your. Y a de la crête couleur? Oui. You have your. Xi n, which falls here. Here you have xn, your point. And what you will do is simply that you will drag x, the former ith component of the grid, here. That means by a dilatation, that means for French speaking people, it's an homothesy. Centered at xi n with a ratio 1 minus gamma n, like that. That's all. And other components are not moved. And that's it. You repeat that, you iterate that 1,000 times, 100,000 times, etc., etc. And you see that in higher dimension, what is important here is the following problem, is that you see like a kind of magic, I go to the blackboard and I say, okay, xn falls here. But that's the main problem. Because when you are in dimension 100, finding the nearest neighbor among 50 prototypes, it's very time consuming. In fact, it is one of the most challenging problems in computer science. how to find efficiently the nearest neighbor point among a set of points in higher dimension. And for example, in the project of SEMRAX this year, some of you will have to work in dimension 1000. And they will have to produce 256 prototypes. And as we want to perform a quantization tree of classification, we have to repeat that at different levels. So we absolutely need to have some very efficient nearest neighbor search procedures. So I won't speak about that today, but in fact, the truth is that you have many methods in low dimension. That means up to 10 or 15. But then you have essentially no solution except the brute force approach. You can do what is called the chain parcel search trick, which is a very easy way to leave his name to the mathematical history. Because the idea is the following. It's when you have when you are in dimension D and you have to beat a record, and then what you do, you have to compute the norm of a vector, so you will be disappointed, and don't wait for anything clever. What you do is the following thing is you call that R, and you say, well, okay, if the square of the first component is greater than R2, probably I won't beat the record, so I give up. And then if Y2 is lower than that, then you try Y1 plus Y2 to the square. If yes, you stop, etc., etc. So that's chain's partial distance search principle. Try to have the same idea and you leave your name in history. But in fact, I understand this mathematician because I think that more than 100 mathematicians in the world who are called Chen. So it's probably on Math Science Net, it's probably the greatest amount. Hmm? What?
The link.
Here, the link. But because Y is Y will be the difference between it will be Xi n, my input, minus Xi from here. So, but well, okay, if I want to write things, I have put the things. Like that, and you Y is here, and so you tested before J up to I minus 1, which produced a record at time I minus 1, and you want to see if the norm to the square of this object will be greater or lower than the record. If it's lower, it's a candidate to be the winner. If it's greater, it's finished. So the idea is to decide whether it's finished or not as soon as possible. And you use this partial distance search method. Okay. The gamma n is something else. Gamma n is a step, it's a gain step in the stochastic gradient descent. It has nothing to do with the nearest neighbor search. The nearest neighbor search, you also have it in the Lloyd procedure. I didn't emphasize at that moment, but it's a common feature to all methods to quantize, in fact. So let's look at the result of our efforts. So here you have a random quantizer for the normal distribution of size 500. And then once you have done what I said, you have a big flower like a tournesol. Which is an hopefully not too far to optimality quantizer for the same distribution. And at this stage, to switch to other results, we can look at what is called the Bennett's conjecture, which can be introduced through this colored approach. What is the color here except for the cells on the boundary close to infinity? In fact, you imagine that the cells are at the temperature of their weight. So if it's cold, it's black. If it's very, very hot, it's yellow. And if it's extremely hot, it's white. And you see, it's obvious here, I guess, that some of you should see this drawing in three dimensions. In fact, you have an optical illusion. You should have an optical illusion. But anyway, you see that the aim of quantization is not to equalize the weights of the cells. It's not a procedure which produces cells with the same weights. It's clearly not its purpose. So let's come back to one dimension and see what does optimal quantization do. Here we have our optimal quantizer with 50 points in one dimension. Here, it's the blue circle, or the purple small circle on the abscissa axis here. And here you have two drawings. Here you say, okay, the speaker wanted to recall us that it's the normal distribution here that is quantized. That's not my purpose. And here you have a flat straight line like that. And if you look at what happens, you see that in fact, this line here, the red flat line here, is in fact the local inertia. That means we computed the local inertia of every cell of x on every cell. That means the expectation of x minus xi to the square indicator function that x belongs to this cell. And then we depict xi, this inertia, and you see that the aim, in fact, of optimal quantization is to equalize the inertia of all the cells. All the cells have the same inertia. And what is more interesting and exciting for a mathematician, this local inertia is constant. And now let us look at the weights. If you do some fitting of this curve, but this curve is in fact you depict the weights. That means that to xi, I map xi to the weight of its cell. Here. And you see that it have a Gaussian shape. And in fact, when you do a precise fitting, you see that in fact, this curve is exactly fit with a Gaussian distribution with density, the original density to the power 1/3 divided by the appropriate constant to make this probability distribution, as the sum of the weights, of course, is equal to 1. So that's very bizarre. But it's in fact a part of the Bennett conjecture. Bennett conjecture in its weak form says that in any dimension D, LP optimal quantizer satisfies that the local inertia of each cell is approximately equal to the global quantization error. I should have written to the 2, là, because everything is the inertia corresponds to the square of the local of the quantization error, divided by the number of cells, and the weight of each cell is equal to a constant, normalizing constant. The original density, here I put the normal density, but in fact it's true for any, enfin, it's supposed to be true for any probability density, to the power d over d plus p. So in the former case, it was a quadratic case in one dimension, hence it was 1/3. So in fact, in dimension one, it's not very difficult to check, and with my colleague Jean-Claude Faure at the 15 years ago, we established the result for a large class of distribution. But when D is greater than 1, so greater than 2, it remains true in a measure sense. It's not difficult to prove in some sense. That means that you can construct some measure associated to this quantity and then show that converge to something which is consistent with this approximation. But there is no pointwise proof of any kind as soon as d is greater than 2, or maybe 3, maybe for 2 there are some partial results, but well, it's a completely open conjecture. But in fact, it's not the true conjecture. The true strong Bennett conjecture is a conjecture of the geometric form of the Voronoi cell are essentially that of the uniform distribution over the unit hypercube. That means that in dimension 2, it's a regular hexagon. In dimension 3, it's a regular octahedron. And in dimension greater than 4, nobody knows. Nobody proves anything, and I think nobody knows. But you see that strong Bennett's conjecture is satisfied here. You see that locally, you have some regular hexagon, so everything not everything is not perfect, but you see that these ones are quite regular. So this conjecture is undoubtedly true and probably absolutely out of reach, at least by purely probabilistic mean, that's for sure. But it would be really nice already to prove this, which is the measure weak form of the conjecture. So just to show you that you can quantize something else than the normal distribution, here you have some, it's not really a cobweb, it could be, but it's in fact the optimal quantization of the joint law of Brownian motion and its supremum over 0,1, equipped with their Voronoi diagram. Okay, so these are now some results in the framework of clustering. So you have that if you assume, for example, which is a generic situation in which people are interested in data mining, you consider an IID sequence of data with distribution mu. So you assume that your data set is a sample of an IID sample of a given distribution, and you consider the random empirical measure associated to this random variable. And then if you assume that all these data are in fact contained in the unit ball, then you can show that the quadratic quantization error between the law of x1 of your one data, the optimal quantization error induced by this grid, which depends on omega, of course, because for every omega you have a data set in some sense, and each data set gives rise to an optimal grid, and then you consider the expectation of the minimal quantization error minus the quantization error of the true. This is the quantization error induced by the optimal grid for mu n, but applied to mu. That means I look at the, in some sense, at which rate the optimal quantization grid for the empirical mean converge to the true quantization grid for the distribution mu. So we consider the quantization error induced by this random optimal grid associated to mu n omega d xi. We take the expectation of this error and we compare it to the minimal quadratic quantization error induced by mu. And you have this upper bound among others, which has been established by my colleague Gérard Biot from laboratoire de statistique at UPMC. So you have that it goes to zero as n goes to infinity at a rate which is essentially log n over n, with a comparison, but you have a competition given the size of the quantization, which is capital N. You have other results of this kind in the paper in Annals of Probability by Graf and Lushgi, but there is no result if you want to exercise your expertise in probability and statistics. There is no result in the case where the distribution has not compact support. Okay, let's go back to finish to numerical probability and try to understand how to use it beyond the this cubature formula that that I spoke about already in the first part of the course, as we saw that you can have some error bounds when you compute the expectation of f of x by its quantized approximation, like that. And we already saw that optimal quantization. So I go fast because I already showed these similar slides. That optimal quantization is optimal for the class of Lipschitz functions. That means that the L1 optimal quantization error for a random variable x is equal exactly to the L1 Wasserstein distance between the law of x and the set of probability which are atomic with at most capital N atoms. Okay, what is more interesting is the second order result, still for cubature. That means that if a function f is C1 with Lipschitz differential and if the grid is stationary, because it's L2 optimal, for example, so satisfies our friend stationarity equation, then a Taylor expansion of f of x at x hat shows that this quantity is equal to the explanation of f of x minus its quantized counterpart minus the gradient of f of x hat times scalar product x minus x hat. But this quantity, as usual, x minus x hat, you see that this quantity is orthogonal to all functions which are functions of x hat. That means that, of course, the expectation of this quantity is equal to zero. So, in fact, you have, instead of a first order estimate, you have a second order estimate. That means instead of the L1 quantization error to the one, now you have the L2 quantization error to the two. So the L2 quantization error is slightly larger than the L1 quantization error, but of course to the square, now that we know that it goes to zero as one over the size of the grid to the one over D, of course it's much more efficient to have that. But still, it's not so interesting because it's always cubature formula. For integral, we can note that it's a straightforward consequence of Jensen's inequality that stationarity implies that in fact, in case of a convex function, the quantized quadrature cubature formula is always upper bounded by the true value. So it's interesting to know that because if you have several grids, you can compute several proxy by quantization, and you know that in fact the best among them will be the highest one because all of them are upper bound by the true value. So where it becomes a bit more interesting is that when you look at what I spoke in the introduction of the course, which was conditional expectation. So imagine that we quantize x hat, x by x hat and y by y hat, but I forget about Voronoi quantization, optimal quantization. It's true. This is true for any x hat function of x and y hat function of y, provided everybody is integrable, which is of course for free when you have some quantization by a finite grid. Okay, and now you have this Pythagoras theorem for conditional expectation, which says that if you have a transition py of du, which is the law of x given y equal to small y, which is a regular version of the conditional distribution of x, and we assume that, in that case, we have that the expectation of g of x given y is equal to pg of y. And then, what I claim is that if you approximate the expectation of g of x given y by its quantized counterpart, that means the expectation of g of x hat given y hat to the square, this is lower than the Lipschitz. So we assume, of course, it's meaningful if g and p of g will be Lipschitz. If g is Lipschitz, it's upper bounded by the square of the Lipschitz coefficient times x minus x hat L2 to the square. And you have the same with pgy minus bgy hat. And if p propagates Lipschitz continuity. That means, in some sense, if P is continuous, is Lipschitz for the Wasserstein distance, L2 Wasserstein distance. In fact, you can show that here you can replace, of course, this by the Lipschitz coefficient of PG times the quantization error of Y. So that means that you have this kind of Pythagoras theorem that when you approximate a continuous expectation, but its quantized counterpart, the error to the square is essentially the sum of the squared quantization error in the quadratic sense of the upper part and the lower part of your conditional expectation. And how to prove that? So the second proof of the course, the last one, it's still the same trick. You say that PGY minus the expectation of PGY given Y hat is orthogonal to all function in L2 of P, in all function, to all function which are function of Y hat. And so you introduce artificially in your error term this quantity here, so that this quantity will be by structurally orthogonal in L2 of P to this quantity which is a function of Y hat. So by Pythagoras theorem, this time the true one, you have the square of this L2 norm is equal to the square of this two L2 norm of these two terms. And then you see it's very elementary, in fact. You see that then you just have to use the fact that PG and G are Lipschitz. When P is different from 2, unfortunately, you cannot do that, so you have to use the Minkowski inequality, and then you have a much less interesting inequality. You have the same kind of inequality, but you cannot use this orthogonality property, so you don't have the square or the power P here. So far, we didn't succeed in proving that. And that leads us to what is, in some sense, one of the aim of using this cubature formula for conditional expectation. We consider a standard BSDE, backward stochastic differential equation, with terminal value h of xt, where xt is a standard diffusion. F, the driver, depends on the diffusion, on the backward itself, on z, which is the hedging term in some sense. That means the z which appears in the representation theorem for Brownian martingales here. A solution of such a BSDE, of course, it's a couple y z, which are the two unknowns of this in this equation. And we assume that everybody is Lipschitz, b, sigma, h, in x, uniformly in t, etc., etc. F itself is Lipschitz, etc. Okay, so it's the probabilistic representation, as mentioned this morning, of a partially nonlinear PD. So I won't spend time on the PD aspect at this moment. And then the one way, but as it has been already mentioned this morning, the first step when solving this such a BSDE is to produce a time discretization scheme here. So in that case, what you do, you just write an Euler scheme with a specificity here, which is of course that y bar tnk plus 1 is not adapted to ftnk, so you must condition y tnk plus 1 by the past of the Brownian motion, the filtration of the Brownian motion up to time tnk, and here when you discretize the integral, there are different ways to proceed. Sometimes you do the conditioning outside F. There are very variants, many variants, but the variant we adopted with Abbasagna, with whom I made this work recently, is to introduce here inside F again this conditional expectation. And then we need an approximation for Z, and for Z, for those who are familiar with that, it's very simple. For the other one, you will believe me. You just make a projection against the increment of the Brownian motion, and then you have exactly an approximation of Z by zeta bar tnk like that. Okay, and what is X bar here? X bar is the standard Euler scheme of the diffusion. I should have maybe started by that. So, what is interesting in that is here, as you can see, I could have, but I made the conditioning with respect to the filtration. In fact, you can prove by induction that you can replace here this filtration by X bar TNK. That means there is a Markovian property which says that X, Y bar is a function of X bar TNK. In fact, you can even prove, okay, I won't go beyond because those who knows will learn nothing and the other either. So, okay, but what is important is that what we propose as a quantization procedure is just to put hat everywhere, but I just come back to this here anyway. It's true, but it's more than true. It's very convenient here to replace the filtration by X bar TNK because you have a function in that case. And you have the right to do that, it can be proved. And then what we do in the case of quantization is that we'll force this Markov property in some sense. That means that here I introduce the operator E hat of K, which is the conditioned expectation given X hat of K. That means that I don't try to prove that the quantization of my Euler scheme is a Markov process, which is not true, in fact. So I shouldn't be able to prove it. But I behave as if it were true, and I make the conditioning everywhere with respect to X hat K. Of course, I will pay a price for that in the error bounds. And by induction, you can prove, it's very easy under this form, that Y hat K, as defined here, is in fact, there is a missing equal term here, is equal to V hat K of X hat K. It's a function of V hat K, and in that case, so in that case, you can prove that this quantity, which is involved in the hedge term, in the Z term, can be also written as a function of X hat K times the Brownian increment. So in that case, you can proceed. You have a true algorithm. That means you have a backward algorithm that you can follow from, like for American option, from the terminal time to the origin. Okay, so you produce a quantization tree. That means that here you have, for example, four time layers, 0, 1, 2, 3. And then to each time layer, at each time step, you assign N0 point here, N1 point here, N2 point, and N3 points here to quantize the value of X hat K at time 0, 1, 2, and 3. So this is a very small one-dimensional quantization tree. With that, you won't price many things. So at time tk, at time k, or in fact time tk, because we use k in time instead of tk to alleviate notations, we make the usual projection of x tk or x bar tk. When you can simulate x tk, you use x tk. When you cannot, you use an Euler scheme, as I described in my former slide. So you have this projection here. So this quantization tree is not recombining, but that's the cons of this quantization tree. But what is in favor of this quantization tree is that you can control its size a priori. Of course, you will pay it in terms of precision in your result, but you can make something which does not explode without special measures. You can do it for, it will never explode, it will naturally behave, it will naturally be stay under control. So now we have to calibrate this quantization tree. And what do we need? We need to compute this kind of quantity, the expectation of a function of x hat k plus 1 given x hat k. Keep in mind that k means tk, k plus 1, tk plus 1. And thinking of the hedging term, you have to compute some function of x hat k plus 1 against a Brownian increment given x hat k. So it's very easy to compute, it's very elementary to compute that this expectation taken when x hat k, it's not the conditioning, it's the joint distribution here, x phi of x hat k plus 1, indicator function of x hat k equal to x k I, is equal to this sum where the term of interest are in fact p hat k, I should have written I j here. where this quantity are in fact the probability to be in the jth cell of the grid at time k plus 1, being in the ith cell of gamma k at time k. So in some sense, that means that you compute the probability that if you are in the cell of this point, what is the probability to be in the cell of this point and in the cell of this point between time k and k plus 1. So it's the upper part of the conditional expectation here, of the conditional probability here. And for the z terms, you do exactly the same thing. You have p tilde wk instead of p hat k, and you just have to compute this quantity. And the idea is that if you compute this quantity p hat and p tilde here, you can compute everything. As you can check here, I put a generic function phi and not the function which are the v hat k function or this function which could be called v tilde k plus v tilde k, etc., etc., etc. I just consider a generic function. So once you have computed this quantity, you can compute all the quantity related to your quantization tree for free. And it's clear, so you have a quantized, it's just a form of quantized forward Kolmogorov equation on weights. That means that, of course, you can write the weight of associated to the distribution of x hat at time k as the sum of the p k minus 1 ij, which are computed at the former time layer, etc., etc. And so you can compute this quantity by dividing, you can replace this quantity by this quantity, and you can replace the upper part of the ratio by this quantity. And everything can be computed offline. So, as I said, when you can use the true process at time tk, it's good news, but usually you can't, and then you use a discretization scheme. And then you have to do the grid optimization. So you consider, so you must do some Monte Carlo simulation somewhere. So in some sense, a quantization tree is a compressed Monte Carlo method. That means you make a compression of your Monte Carlo sample. So you make capital M copies of your Markov chain, let's say, which is either the discretization scheme, either the processus itself sample at time tk. And then you perform your grid optimization. That means you let the sample pass through the quantization tree using either a randomized load procedure or a CLVQ at every time tk to produce the optimal grids gamma k, or at least some optimized grids. And then as a second step, you calibrate your p hat k ij and your p tilde kij, like that. You just do some Monte Carlo, so you count the path which starts from a cell and go to another cell, etc., etc. You have some counters, and then you do the same using, here you have to compute this quantity, which is a bit more involved, and in that case, you have to probably use some cubature formula based on the quantization-based formula using pre-computed grids in higher dimension. And the alternative to that is to have an embedded optimal quantization. That means that you will perform the optimization and the calibration simultaneously. So it's a kind of adaptive approach. It's faster, but it's less. You can prove that things work. It gives nice theorem with a nice central limit theorems, full of martingales. It's very pleasant for mathematics. But in practice, I recommend to do that and to use various variance reduction methods, as mentioned this morning, of course. But in the end, you obtain this kind of a priori error estimates. That means that you have that at time k, the error between your time discretization of your backward and your quantized version of your discretization, L2 norm to the square, is lower than the sum of terms which are controlled. I don't give details, but they don't explode when the mesh goes to zero, when the size of the mesh goes to zero. And it's the sum of the error induced, the square of the L2 error induced by the quantization of each time layer, like that. And so you have an error which is upper bounded by the number of instant of discretization divided by capital N to the 2 over D. So it's the square of the error. So if you take the error itself, it will be proportional, upper bound by the square root of the number of time discretization instant divided by capital N to the 1 over D. So this result is rather recent because in fact in very, very long time ago when the people were a bit excited by computing American option price in high dimension. We worked with Vlad Bali on a reflected backward stochastic differential equation. So the result was a bit more involved, but essentially it was the same. And we had, in fact, the same result, but without the two here, without the two here. And so, in fact, with this result, we switch from an error term, which was like that. So it was 2003 to an error term, which is the square root of n to 1 over d, like that. And in fact, at that moment, at that time, when we did some numerical test, we knew that this was the right order. So this is the right order. So it's not maybe completely satisfactory, but it's what what quantization can provide. Without special tricks. And you have also a control on the hedge, which is of the same kind. That of course, it's not as good as this one because you have this term is plugged here. So you lose something when you compute the hedge, but it's always the case in any method on Earth. So there is no surprise at this stage. So I have maybe 5 minutes. So I have what are the choice, the possible choice? Maybe I will, I can show you some, okay, but show some numerics like that, it's a bit meaningless. Okay, anyway, I will show you, we treated an example due to Jean-François Chassagneux, which became a classical instance to test backward, not Jean-François Chassagneux, but his example. Sorry. So we consider this backward, which is not really a backward, because you start from the closed form, and then you consider the following backward. X is in fact W, but in fact there is no real underlying X, and dyt is ft of yt zt dt minus zt dwt, and the terminal value of yt is et plus 1 plus e capital T, like that, where f is given by that. And this backward has a closed solution, which is predictable, which in some sense, I think Jean-François started from that. but, huh? Right, using Itô's formula in a very clever way. Well, okay. Anyway, it's a very good test because it's not so demanding, but if it doesn't work with that, you should change. So what we obtain in dimension 3, you see, so you see that in fact it follows essentially what was predicted in dimension 3. It's essentially what the theory predicts, because this is essentially 1 over capital N to the 1/3. So it follows what is predicted by the theory, and we are satisfied in some sense with that. Okay. What I wanted to speak to, just to finish, in fact, it's probably the most exciting part of the optimal quantization theory, and so far it has not so many applications, but well, you cannot always apply things. It's towards this Bennett's conjecture. So it's a work that we made with Siegfried Graf and Arend Lushgi a few years ago, which was to try to get closer to understand this Bennett's conjecture. So our first result was to differentiate discrete differentiation, of course, of the LP distortion, that means the power P of the LP quantization error. And we showed that you remember that this quantity is of order 1 over n to the P over D. So you can hope that if you make the difference between two terms, you will obtain something like that. And the answer is yes. It took 2 years, but the answer is yes. And then you have an upper bound, some upper bounds, in the direction of the Bennett's conjecture. That means if you suppose that phi, the density of X, is essentially bounded, let's say, completely bounded, with compact support, and is peakless. That means that there is no peak in the support. That means that wherever you are in the support, the probability that X belongs to a given ball of radius S, for S small enough, is always lower bounded by the volume of this ball uniformly, of course, in X in the support and S between 0 and S0. In that case, you can prove, towards the Bennett's conjecture, that the maximum of the weights are always bounded by a universal constant, C1 depending on X, but not on capital N, C1 over N. That means that all the weights, in some sense, it almost says that all the weights are approximately of the form C1 over N. It's not, what I say is not true, but it's in the direction of that. And the maximum of the local inertia, that means the LP local inertia over a cell, it's here, it's simple bars again, it's always lower than C bar N minus 1 plus P over D, which is once again in the direction of the Bennett's conjecture. The Bennett's conjecture, in its weak form, says that in fact C1 is essentially the density phi at the point xi to the power, I don't remember exactly, it's d over d plus p, I guess. And here we should have that this quantity is a constant which does not depend on xi, which is the case here, but the lowest one does not depend on xi, because all these quantities are supposed to be, as I said, essentially equal. And since they are essentially equal and that the global error is of the form n minus p over d, it's exactly normal to have a capital N minus 1 plus P over D. But okay, I think that thanks to this result, we made 5% of the way to the Bennett's conjecture, and I hope to reach 6 or 7 in the next 2 years. So thank you very much for your attention.
So, are there any questions or comments? So, one first comment. Mm-hmm. If you go back to this bound you have when you test a function f on the real x and f on the stationary quantizer, showed that there was a cancellation in the first order term because of the fact that the conditional expectation vanishes. It seems to me that you can have the same when f is a general function of the law of x. So instead of having, e of f of x, you take a general function of the law. Mm. It might be interesting since we are speaking of mean field models. Mm. And then you assume that this this functional is...
c'est moi.
It's over. I was saying that if you assume that f is differentiable in the direction of the measure, I think you have the same kind of bounds. You really cancel the first order, and you just keep track of the second order. So this is just one comment to say that maybe this kind of trick might be useful for some mean field or Makin-Vlasov model for a general mean field interaction instead of exactly this type of mean field interaction.
And I think we have to talk. So thank you.
Maybe another question or any? Yeah.
Okay. Excuse me, for the slide 38, when you speak about quantization tree, quantization tree, in fact, yes. So here the number of points at each step is. I didn't understand. It's two. We have two
here,
points.
Here and you have here n zero is equal to one, n one is equal to two, n two is equal to three, and n three is equal to four.
So this n example. Is increasing at each time.
In fact, I didn't speak about that, but once you have all these error bounds, it's possible when you have a budget. Either you give you give to yourself a prescribed accuracy, or you have a budget of number of points you may use, and then you can dispatch across the time layers the NK. There is a way to determine the number of points you use to quantize XK at time K. But I didn't speak about that. You don't choose that a priori. You have a whole protocol,
okay,
in fact.
Because I was thinking about clustering discrete time Markov chains. Mm-hmm. So that's why I was asking if it is there is some facilities for when classifying clustering discrete Markov chains without too much calculus, in fact, mm-hmm. without using big N, in fact, because when we have a discrete Markov chain, of course, we have many possibilities. The dimension of the space is big.
Yeah.
So that's why I was asking if when we use the Markov property, we can.
If you lose the Markov property,
since we have the Markov property, can we make clustering for discrete Markov chains? Using the Markov property or benefiting from the Markov property, I mean.
To quantize the whole path of the Markov chain.
Yes, yes.
Well, in fact, it's possible, but yes. But maybe the best approach in that case is to use functional quantization. That means to directly consider the path or the... Or in discrete time, you can consider the vector and you will be in a very high dimension.
Yes.
So you can do some clustering, yes. You can do some clustering, and in that case, it's not the, here everything is done with the BSD, so it's a very specific case. But in general, as soon as you have some error bounds, you can design the whole quantization tree from nothing, just using these error bounds. Usually, it's of course very conservative, but it works.
Yes, the problem it will be the dimension, in fact.
Yes, of course, and when the dimension is very high. There is a project in the SEMrax to see it's possible to say meaningful things in dimension 1000, but it's highly challenging in my opinion.
Thank you.